Hi, this is Julie Harland, and I'm your math gal. Please visit my website at yourmathgal.com, where you could search for any of my videos organized by topic. This is part 5 of graphing absolute value functions, and we do this problem on this video, f of x equals 4 minus 3, absolute value of x minus 1, and then we summarize the basics of graphing absolute value equations of the of this general form. All right, let's do this problem. We're going to graph and state the vertex, domain, and range of this function, which is an absolute value function. Now, the first thing you might notice is that it's not the way you normally see it with the absolute value sign part first and then a number at the end, but that's okay. What is important to notice is that there is a minus sign in front of the absolute value. That minus sign in front tells you it's going to go down. So you might just kind of make a mental note of that. It's going to be going down. But we start out the same way. To get the vertex, we're going to take whatever's in the absolute value and set it equal to 0 to find the x coordinate. So that means x is 1. Now, what happens when you put in 1 for x into the original? Well, whatever's in the absolute value be 0. So then you're going to have this 3 times 0, which is 0, and you're subtracting 0 from something. So 4 will be the y coordinate. And in fact, if you had rewritten this as f of x equals negative 3, absolute value x minus 1 plus 4, remember this number over here to the right will give you the y coordinate of your vertex point, because this part will end up being 0 since you're going to have some number times 0 anyway. Okay, so we've got 4 for our y coordinate, which means our vertex is 1, 4. So let's plot that. We have 1, 4. And we know it's going down, right? So let's go ahead and check out the symmetry here. It's going to be across that line. And let's find another order pair. How about finding the y-intercept? That's always a good one to find out. So let's see. To find out the y-intercept, remember what you do? You put in 0 for x. So let's plug in 0 for x into that equation. Instead of writing f of x, I'm just going to write y. You'd have 4 minus 3 times 0 minus 1. Now let's see. Can you do that in your head? 0 minus 1 is negative 1. So the absolute value would be 1. Okay? And if you can't do it in your head, here it is. It's going to be, that's going to just be 1 after you take the absolute value. And 4 minus 3 is 1. So the y-intercept is 0, 1. So I now have another point on my graph. And once you get one point, there's this corresponding one right across that axis of symmetry. So I have two more points. Right, so we know what it is when x is 0, 1, and 2 now, right? Because this is an ordered pair 2, 1. How about when putting one more number for x? How about when x equals 3? So I'd have y equals 4 minus 3 times, and I'm going to put in 3 for x, right? I'm sorry, I wrote x equals 0 even though I said 3. So 3 minus 1, all right, so that's 4 minus 3 times, all right, 3 minus 1 is 2, absolute value of 2 is 2. So I've got 4 minus 6, negative 2. All right, so that's the ordered pair. When you plugged in 3, you got negative 2. So if I go over 3, I go down 2. There's a corresponding point over here. And so I'm going to get this very steep half lines, really. And think about the slopes of those lines. Check out the slope between this point and this point. I'm going over 1 and up 3. It's a slope of 3. That's exactly the function of this 3. Because if you multiplied through the absolute value, which actually is allowed, if it's a positive number out here, you could just say you could have had 3x minus 3 in the absolute value. That happens to be a property of absolute value. If you have a positive number times, some junk in here, whatever it is, you can actually just multiply P times the junk inside. All right, so that's a little something you might find useful about absolute values. So 3 is a positive number, I could do that. Okay, so we notice that that 3, if you multiplied through it, would mean you'd have a 3 in front of the x, and so that's really the slope. Plus or minus 3 ends up being the slope of the two half lines, and that's why it looks steeper than usual. All right, so we found the vertex right here. All right, let's just do the domain and range. Domain's always the same thing. It's all real numbers, so it's negative infinity to infinity. All right, what about the range? Well, there's no smallest number because it goes down forever. So negative infinity all the way up to the top, the y value, is it 4, right? And that is always the y coordinate of the vertex. So the range is from negative infinity to 4. All right, so here's a summary of graphing absolute value equations of the form f of x equals a absolute value of bx plus c plus d. Now, it really doesn't matter what's in the absolute value. I don't think it's good to memorize this when I'm going to be writing here, but it's just what we've discovered. The domain is always negative infinity to infinity. We noticed if the number in front of the absolute value was positive, it opened upward, which means there's a bottom point, and that bottom point ends up being D. Remember, D is the y-coordinate of the vertex. Okay, so it's the very bottom y-value. So the range would be from D to infinity. But when A is less than 0, it opens downward like this, kind of a V. So there is no bottom, so negative infinity, and it goes all the way up to D, again, up to the y-coordinate of the vertex. So to find the x-coordinate of the vertex, we just set the expression inside the absolute value equal to 0 and solve for x. So in this case, if I had done bx plus c equals 0, for instance, bx plus c equals 0, you would subtract c from both sides and divide by b, you'd get this negative c over b. I don't want to memorize that. It's just easy to set it equal to 0. It might not always look exactly like, you know, bx plus c. Maybe it's a 3x minus 5, or it's a 2 minus 5x, etc. So whatever's inside there, you set it equal to 0, and you'll get your x-coordinate of the vertex. And so now, this is what we've discovered, again, not to be memorized, but we've worked lots of problems, and so you should be pretty proficient at graphing just about any absolute value function of this form. Notice we're not doing anything where we have something like an x-squared term. Right, so this is only if we just have an x somewhere within the absolute value and all the rest of what you see is numbers.
Please visit my website at yourmathgal.com, where you can view all of my videos, which are organized by topic.